Revel Mystery History, brought to you in part by Dixie Gunworks in Union City, Tennessee.
Hi, I'm Rick Revel, host of a new show called History Highway. Regardless of where you travel in this great country of ours, we drive past little bits and pieces of history each and every day, places where historical events happened. But over the passing of years, those historical events and locations, they've become faded memories. And sadly enough, many of those places, they've ceased to exist, and they're forgotten forever. As I drive down the History Highway, I'll be traveling across country in a 55 Chevy that has a history itself. After she rolled off the assembly line, this puppy became the first successful Chevrolet to have a V8 motor. This model was so popular that it was featured in a movie called American Graffiti. And it was driven by an up-and-coming actor by the name of Harrison Ford. When I was growing up, I was more like Ron Howard. I drove a 58 Chevy. But I'm not here just to talk about antique cars. I'm here to talk about a variety of history. On today's show, not only will I take you back in time, I'll take you up in the wild blue yonder and beyond. So buckle up tight and keep your eyes on the road. We're about to take a trip down the History Highway. It was signs like this that inspired the whole concept of History Highway. This sign talks about the first public building built in the Jackson Purchase. In 1818, working on the behest of the United States government, General Andrew Jackson purchased 8,500 acres of land from the Chickasaw Indians for $300,000. The first permanent settlement in the western Kentucky portion of the Jackson Purchase was established in 1820. By Bannister Wade and called it Wadesboro. This building behind me was built in 1823 in Wadesboro, Kentucky, and was the first courthouse in Callaway County. When Murray became the new county seat in 1843, this log structure was moved to this location, which is now part of Central Park. No matter where you travel in this great country of ours, you're surrounded by history, and even historical markers themselves have a history. The oldest historical marker on record dates back to 650 BC and is found in Jerusalem commemorating a temple built for the King of Ekron. In the United States, historical markers began to show up as early as 1755. And after the Civil War, monuments and plaques were erected all over the country. Sightseers would travel for miles in their horse and buggies to walk on the ground where history was made. When the automobile came on the scene, the sense of adventure went to a whole new level. America was about to be discovered once again. With the highway system slowly improving, historical markers began to pop up in Virginia in 1926. We even find other states like Colorado, Indiana, and Pennsylvania claiming to have posted historical plaques even before then. At the close of World War II, the interest in American history was on the rise,
and historical markers begin to pop up by the hundreds. As of last count, there are nearly 128,000 of these educational signs, with new ones being erected yearly, and each one containing a small nugget of facts that are usually not found in any classroom.
So the next time you're driving and you pass a sign like this, turn around and go back and give it a read, because there's a history lesson waiting just for you. And speaking of a history lesson, it's time for me to climb back in the Chevy. I'm gonna take you to another sign, and this one's gonna blow your mind. This sign right here, it inspired a man some 20 years ago to become an expert on Nathan Stubblefield. And that's what our next story is gonna be about.
According to a book written by Bob Locht, Nathan Stubblefield was born in 1860 on a farm near Murray, Kentucky. Through the years, he spent a great amount of time reading publications like Scientific American and Electrical World. His first patent was issued in 1885. And during an experiment in 1892, his voice was heard by his neighbor, Rainey Wells, who was listening on a separate wireless receiver. Before long, newspapers were writing stories about Nathan Stubblefield and his discoveries. In 1902, he even transmitted music over his wireless system. So what did he invent? A wireless telephone? Or possibly a radio? For these answers, we now turn to Dr. Thomas O. Morgan, who I interviewed during a recent video conference.
Now, you told me that you were driving in this neck of the woods, as we call it, and you found an interesting historical marker.
Yeah, you're very right. It was, and I can tell you the exact date, it was March 14th, 1965, and I'm driving down 641 coming into Murray, and it's cold, it's raining, it's about 4:30 in the evening, and it was sleeting, trying to snow, and I see this roadside marker in my headlights, and it said birthplace of radio. Well, I thought, I've never heard of this, so I literally stopped up, backed up on the highway, and put my headlights full on the sign, and it said, basically, Nathan Bowman Stubblefield, the inventor of radio, was born in this town. And I thought, that's interesting. You know, my dad's a pioneer, and I've been in broadcasting a lot of years, and I've never heard of him.
I understand he was a farmer, but how did he, you know, was he on a family farm, or can you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, he was born in Murray, Kentucky in 1860, the year actually the Civil War began. And he was indeed a farmer. He was one of four brothers, and he was interested in the whole business of wireless telephony.
So isn't that kind of how he stumbled onto some of this technology?
Well, he knew of the telephone. And he created, he actually held four patents. One of the patents was on what he called a laryngophone, which was a strictly sound-powered telephone. It was a system whereby it worked with wires, and it would go back and forth like between a house and a barn, or between a doctor's office and a pharmacy, that kind of thing. It was very crude, but it was patentable, and it worked. And that was the system he installed. But when eventually the Bell telephone came to Murray, that put him out of business. And he could see that coming. So that's why he began to think, well, I can go Bell one better if I can create a telephone, or if I can make his telephone work without wires. And he actually did work with Bell telephones in the early days. And if you look at some of the pictures, which I donated to the library, the Stubblefield collection at the Pogue Library at Murray State University, you'll see that he's working with Bell telephones. And it was those telephones that he made wireless.
What was that device? Can you explain that to me?
Good question, Rick. First of all, the device itself. It was basically an induction system. Stubblefield was working in the frequencies between 20 and 20,000 cycles. Today they're called 20,000 hertz. Those are called the audio frequencies. That's what you and I are communicating with right now, what we hear. radio frequency really doesn't begin until you get to 100,000 cycles, and from there it goes on up into the mega cycles and so on. So he was working outside of what the traditional broadcast band was. Number two, he basically had two Bell telephones, which he had rigged with copper wire rings, antenna, a receiving and a transmitting antenna. And when he spoke into one phone, they were battery powered. When he spoke into one phone, it induced a current in the second phone. And it was good for about a mile, and it worked very well for about a mile, but it was an induction system. It was not a broadcast system. So what he really invented, what he proved could be done, others had theorized it could be done, but Stubblefield actually did it, is he would transmit the human voice without wires. Forget for a moment whether it's an induction or a broadcast system. He did it. He actually made it work, and he demonstrated it in Murray repeatedly. He demonstrated it from the steamer Bartholdi to the Riverside in Washington, D.C. He did it in New York City. So there's no question, but what he was the first person ever to actually demonstrate wireless voice communication. That is the niche that he has been denied by all these overclaims that he was the father of radio.
You had mentioned the time that he went wireless in the Potomac River, and he supposedly played a musical instrument, and was that a harmonica that he played? And if so, what was the song he played?
That's a good question. It was indeed a harmonica. They called him a mouth harp. And the original ones that he had done back in Murray, his son Bernard was the one. You really couldn't say he was playing it because he told me he really couldn't play it, but he just blew into it just to show that music was possible to transmit. And in the Washington, D.C. Demonstration, it was actually played by the son of a United States senator. Again, his name escapes me. It's been many years. But he could actually play the harmonica, and he did. And it was heard from ship to shore and from shore to ship.
Thank you, Dr. Morgan, for your time.
You're most welcome. Happy to do it.
My crew keeps me on the road from episode to episode. To the metal and a Latin.